Giannis, KD, Middleton, Kyrie. It's rare to get back-to-back games between two conference powerhouses, and it gave us a lot of insight into what a matchup between these two teams would look like if they squared off in the postseason. And while the Nets might shrug and say, wait until Harden gets back on the court, the Bucks made a very loud statement, and it might be the key to them winning an NBA title. The most important aspect of this miniseries was how the Nets were going to defend Giannis, and they made their intentions clear from the start. Put DeAndre Jordan on him, give him a ridiculous amount of space, and dare him to shoot from the outside. Giannis shot horribly between 10 and 20 feet, and the key is to give him a lot of space, but then get in the air to contest them tightly once he goes to shoot it. This part of the chess match goes to Steve Nash, and Mike Budenholzer has got to tell Giannis to simply stop dribbling into these areas and settling for this shot. He needs to completely eliminate them. I charted all of Giannis' two-point shots to see who was guarding him and who had the most success. And it was Blake Griffin who limited his percentage the most, primarily because he could hold off Giannis' initial shoulder as a battering ram move and goad him into jumpers. This type of defense is in direct contrast to the way they defended him behind the three-point arc. The Nets were content to let him bomb away, considering how poorly he's been shooting them his whole career. Giannis ended up hitting 40% of these over the two games, and that's pretty good. But without question, the percentage is low for what a decent shooter would do with this much space. The Nets would be wise to do a little more contesting of these shots as well, since the head flare is Giannis' natural reaction to defense and a primary reason why he misses. Of course, Giannis did average 42.5 points, and where he really hurt the Nets was when he simply refused to settle for anything less than a point-blank shot at the rim. This is where the gamble of giving him a ton of space can backfire, as he gets a head of steam going, uses his shoulders as weapons, and overcomes the defense with his length and power. There's no question he can overwhelm the opponent throughout the game, and Steve Nash could say it was worth it, considering they quote-unquote held his two-point field goal percentage to 52%, compared to his usual 63% on the season. It did allow the Nets defenders to stay at home on perimeter shooters, but if you compare the Bucks' three-point frequency and percentage for the whole season to what they did over these two games, guarding Giannis one-on-one, giving him tons of space, and not leaving the shooters had a negligible effect on the Bucks' attack. But when you examine how Giannis' teammates shot threes while he was on the floor, Nash could definitely argue the strategy paid off. As part of this chess match, Nash tried to get away with suboptimal lineups to start both fourth quarters, and it cost them dearly, as the Bucks took advantage by having both Chris Middleton and Giannis in together. With Durant and Kyrie stuck on the bench, we saw the beginnings of runs that couldn't be stopped once they got going, and it was too late by the time Nash got his stars back into the game. In Game 1, it was a 16-3 run that featured Chris Middleton early as he steps back to hit the tough long two off the ball screen from Giannis, and then doing his role as the go-to guy for them in the fourth by straight isolating on Griffin, hitting him with a jab step before hopping into a quick-release splash from behind the arc. And they bookended the run with a walk-up Giannis 3 when Blake doesn't challenge up top, and then Kyrie inexplicably switches onto Giannis. Durant cleans that mistake up quick, but instead of letting him take a very inefficient turnaround fadeaway from 12 feet, Durant hacks him across the arm, bailing him out with two free throws. In Game 2, it was an 18-1 run that just about ended the game early, and it was indicative of all that's wrong with the Nets' 14th-ranked defense this season. They give up the 7th most offensive rebounds per game, and despite Blake getting Giannis to take the exact shot they wanted, Mike James separated himself foolishly from his man, allowing DiVincenzo to get two offensive boards before putting it back in. With Lopez getting away with contact across the arm on Shamit's drive and layup attempt that misses, it allows the Bucks to attack 4-on-3, and Bryn Forbes gets a generous interpretation of the gather step from the referees as he steps into an open 3. Mike James again gets beat, this time on a classic give and go, as DiVincenzo gets a catch at the dotted line and there was nothing Blake could do at this point to stop him. The Bucks run a ball screen in the mid-post area to force a switch and get a mismatch with James guarding Holiday. Not content with that size disparity, they force another switch so Middleton could go to work on him. I don't blame Jeff Green for wanting to hover in the area to provide support, but it allowed an easy bounce pass to the dunker spot. Credit to KD for the proper rotation, but Holiday tells him to get back in the weight room with a hip check across the lane for an easy layup. On the out-of-bounds play, a very typical action for NBA teams is to back screen the inbounder. Green doesn't help on the cut, leaving Brown two steps behind for the nice bounce pass and yet another layup to increase the lead to four. After the poor decision by Durant to shoot this surrounded by three defenders, they get caught in a weird cross match with Kyrie defending Brook Lopez. This sucks KD to the lane line to offer support, and it allows a quick skip pass. Notice how Middleton lifts both feet in the air on the catch, then splits his feet to immediately explode into the baseline drive before KD ever had a chance. Hard to believe, but the Bucks get another layup. And to top off this 18-1 run in spectacularly embarrassing fashion for the Nets defense, first, they completely lose Bryn Forbes on a screwed-up switch between Brown and Durant, but get away with it by not giving up a layup. But then, Griffin is asleep as Middleton curls around his man's screen to get right to the basket for another layup over two shorties. For all the fireworks from Giannis' impressive basket-making in these two games, the Bucks are still left with him as a liability in crunch time. In the last 5 minutes of these two games combined, he was 2-for-9 from the field with two turnovers. And the shots he missed were exactly what the Nets wanted him to do, settling for outside jumpers after giving him lots of space. And with the score as tight as it was for both of these games, it has to be unsettling that he fell into their trap so often, considering what was working so well for them. Giannis has to be thankful for his teammates for coming to his rescue down the stretch with clutch baskets from Connaughton on this three ball, and then Chris Middleton again looking like Kobe to create this shot off the dribble before hitting the heavily contested long two-point shot for a crucial six-point lead. In Game 2, they did get a timely crunch time assist from Giannis from the high post, as KD shows early help on the roll man. Joe Harris has to make a decision, stay with the player under the basket or go back to the corner. Let's just say, he chose unwisely. They run the same pick and roll, with Kyrie zoning up on the free throw line and KD so focused on the ball, he's way late in reacting to the skip pass, giving Middleton enough room to knock down this nail in the coffin before the basketball gods look down upon Middleton, guiding this lob to Giannis directly into the basket for an insurmountable 8-point lead. It's clear the Nets' defense isn't capable enough to get consistent and meaningful stops against a team as good as the Bucks, and that the only way to overcome this fatal flaw is to get James Harden back in the lineup so they can simply outscore their mistakes. I do feel that this would be the difference in a series, but with a tricky injury like a hamstring, who knows whether Harden can come back in time and at full strength. That said, if there's one team uniquely qualified to defend the offensive juggernaut that is the full-strength Brooklyn team, it's the Bucks, with Giannis, Middleton, and Holiday being tremendous defenders at the precise positions they need to match up with Brooklyn. Which leaves us all with the coaching chess match. And so far, it's been Mike Budenholzer tipping over Nash's king in checkmate. As we get towards the end of the season and the playoffs, make sure to subscribe and turn on your notifications to get the latest breakdowns on the NBA. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up and throw a comment down below. After all, at BBALL Breakdown, we're not a channel, we're a conversation. You in?